Oh, great. Thank you for playing. This talk talks about a bunch of different things. Before I talk about the talk, let me just do a brief intro. We're already good at this. Here's a good PowerPoint showing off some features. For those of you who are, I'm sure some of you are familiar with Riot and some aren't, we're about 500 people now. We're a global company. We have substantial offices in Korea, Seoul, Korea, Dublin, Ireland, and then two places in the U.S., our headquarters in L.A. and our satellite office in St. Louis, Missouri. I think we were one of the first Western developers to really focus on online games as a service. And that was a trend in Asia before it was a trend in the West, but we wanted to really adopt that in the U.S. And I think League of Legends' success was in large part due to that choice. We're also really focused on making games that have global appeal. And that's not about mashing up a bunch of stuff to make it work. It's really about the idea that highly engaging competitive experiences read well in a lot of cultures, and as you make choices creatively, some things will just tend to read better everywhere. Let's go into my talk a little bit. As you know, we work with Korea here in Singapore, the reason we're part of Korea is I think Korea really shares a lot of the same values as we do. We're a very player-centric company, that we focus on being attentive to what players desire and what they want, and delivering a really good experience to them, with the assumption that if we have a good relationship with players and keep that relationship, then our company will eventually be successful, and it has been. And Korea takes the same view. I mean, they're one of the largest gaming platforms in the world, and they've also taken this approach. With that goal in mind, it's been really easy for us to collaborate with them. Successfully. I mean, it's, League of Legends is a top three game here in Singapore and in Malaysia, and then it's a top game in Taiwan by a very large margin. And we just celebrated a million active players in Taiwan, which is a lot for a country with about 25 million people. So, anyway, to go into my talk, game design has been a field for a while, and if you look back at, like, Super Mario Brothers, most of what you need to know is contained there. So, as an industry, we know how to design games correctly, or at least some people have, for a really long time. And even then, like, people who have previously done really good work or what have you will still make really serious errors. And I believe that that there are some consistent reasons this happened that are unrelated to the talent level or knowledge level of the designer. And that's really what this talk is about. It's also just about how humans make poor decisions in organizations for a lot of other reasons. So I think a couple patterns that cause big mistakes happen. One is just that if you have a process that impedes good decision making, you're not going to make good decisions. So as an example, if I said to a designer, make me a great game in 2 days, it's just not possible, right? The process makes it possible. That's a really simple example, but I think that there's lots of other things, right? It's like, well, we have this restriction or that restriction. In an aggregate, it really impedes decisions. Another is that designers are people, and they're influenced by emotional or social factors. So you didn't want to tell someone that the work didn't work, the work they did didn't work because you didn't want to hurt their feelings. Or you didn't... you personally attached to something you did, and even though it's not very good, people are telling you that you're not really keen on acknowledging that, and that's kind of a consistent problem I think we run into. And lastly, I think that people accept unnecessary constraints because fighting a constraint is kind of you're raising your hand and you're saying, excuse me, this doesn't really make sense. And if we did that all the time, we wouldn't get anything done. But sometimes we do need to do that. And I think that's where a lot of bad decisions come from. So, by the way, unnecessary constraints often just come from, just too many inputs into the process or not understanding the difference between, requirements and preferences. So I'm gonna provide a bunch of examples throughout this talk, but most of the solutions to these problems, you know, have to do with setting a process that facilitates good decisions. So for example, I'll talk a lot about peer review as an important part of game development from my perspective. And peer review, you know, if it's done effectively, will tend to cause people to call out when something's of subpar quality, right? And there's a lot of other processes that you can implement. Another is, you know, if you're managing design for you, if you have, you know, your peer that's more junior designer or what have you, you can coach people towards productive behaviors. Even if you're at a peer-peer level in another department, like, you can encourage people to do things that result in better outcomes. And lastly, I mean, if you're a manager and you know, as students, obviously, you guys are not managers in companies for the most part, but maybe you are within your own projects. But someday, you will be managers in companies, and you have to make really careful mind decisions with game designers, because some people have personality traits that will allow them to be very successful, and some will have personality traits that constantly impede their ability to make good decisions. So just going through my talk, I'm going to go through some anecdotes, because I think that, you know, kind of going by examples is much better than, you know, general talks. Most people learn more by the way. So, the first talk about Omen, which is a character we can't see. And Omen's kind of an example of how saying something is bad is hard, but saying that something is not great is much easier. The next is the Grand Unveil, and this is mostly just about how failing to relay feedback from an idea can often resolve a lot of wasted effort. I'm also going to talk about too awesome to cut, and this is when we have a really great idea we fall in love with, we don't want to cut it because it's really great, but it actually is deeply flawed. I'm talking about forgotten goals, and this is a little more subtle. This has to do with when you're trying to satisfy a bunch of objectives, and you get really deep in the lead, satisfying one or two, and just fail to notice that you've undermined the third or fourth. And then creative fatigue, which is when we try to come up with a bunch of original ideas, and humans just have, you know, maximum rates that can do this at, which might be insufficient for what you're trying to do. And lastly, designing for yourself, which is that many of us as avid game players fall into, where we fail to recognize the difference between what we personally enjoy and what our audience enjoys. And as I go through these, I'm going to just kind of give an example and then also talk about you know, why I think it happens and how you might go about mitigating the risk. And I also encourage you as I go through this, like, think about which of these actually does apply to your personality. Some of these will, if I go through this list, it's, you know, six items. So as I go through these, you'll probably find that you know, two or three of them just absolutely do not apply to you. And that's good. You know, you can be happy with those. But some of them will apply to you. And think about, you know, with the last thing I worked on or the thing I was thinking about, am I falling prey to one of these? Because probably you have them and where you are. So this is Omen. And Omen was a Google Legends character that was about 50% done that we never completed. And, you know, does anyone think this is, how many people here think this is like, you know, like a C minus? Now, does anyone think this is, but how many people here think this is like a B plus? Like, you guys think so fine. Okay, so, alright, so anyway, I don't think it's great. And we took some internal surveys of the company, and, you know, we don't really go off the surveys, but we sometimes use them to test certain ideas. And if we're doing a survey and we say, like, well, on a 1 to 10 scale, what is it? And lots of people are saying, ah, it's an 8, it's a 7, it's an 8, right? Like, that's actually not very good. What you want is that enough people will say, like, that's a 10, I love it, right? Because, like, that's what makes people grow attached to a character and want to play it, right? So now that I've already told you that I don't think this is that great, I think it's okay, does anyone have any ideas why this is not great? The 11 players. What's the good graph? Okay, so visual differentiation is a problem. Seriously, guys, there's plenty of problems to find here, so if you have no idea, you can guess, you'll probably hit it. Anybody else going to take it?
Doesn't it suggest its own mechanics as a visual
so what does this guy do? What do you think this guy does? Just looking at it.
Shoot spikes.
Okay.
Plus range melee.
Right. So you think he's melee? You think he's ranged and he's melee? See, that's a problem, right? Like, you know, if I showed you a picture of Ash, everyone understands that Ash is a ranged DPS. No one says, oh, she runs up to you and flicks you in the room. but yeah, like, I'm not sure. Like, it's like, you know, maybe he shoots spikes and I, you know, maybe he just, you know, mirrors at you in a kind of inappropriate way. So he's a ranged DPS. Looks like Cho'Gath. You know, there's some other problems I didn't go into here. We had some problems with technology and four-legged creatures at the time. But fundamentally, people weren't excited, right? Like, none of the leads were like, oh my god, I can't wait till this character comes out, right? And we kept on doing iterations, and it wasn't actually getting better. So 50% in, the executive team made the decision to kill the character, which, you know, messed up the production pipeline and caused a version delay, version to be delayed by a week. It burned the team who had to work extra hours. It really disappointed the people that invested so much creative energy into it. Like, it wasn't the worst decision we made, but it was, you know, one of the not as good decisions for sure. And, you know, like, here's the iteration, right? Well, it's two core personalities. They kind of wanted to sort of like, looking sort of like, you know, Chinese dragon theme a little bit and clarify the issue spikes. It's still not really doing it here. So what happened here was we didn't really clearly define the team what good enough was. And we also didn't, in the process, I was talking about like bad processes, the process doesn't create a clear point where people have to kind of like acknowledge whether or not it was good or not, right? So what happened was, as we did iterations, people would come up to like me and say, hey Tom, we're going to keep working at Omen, and I say, I just don't see how you're going to personify him, and it's not clear if he's ranged DPS or melee. And it was kind of like Cho'Gath, right? Like, the artists were like, oh yeah, no problem, we'll try to address those concerns. And then, you know, the art director, is saying, like, hey, before we get animation tech doesn't work right now, are we sure about this? And the animator's like, I think I can do a pretty good workaround about that, okay? But none of us said, like, no, kill the character, right? So, if instead the producer had come up to me and said, hey, Tom, do you think Omen's going to be a 10? I would say, probably an 8, maybe a 7. And then we would kill the character, right? Because no one actually thought it was going to be a 10. And the takeaway here is that no one really wants to say that thing you've been working on really sucks, right? And actually, Omen didn't really suck. Omen was just kind of like, meh, right? And I think it's really important that you create a process where it's really easy for people to say that instead of saying it's meh, saying, well, it's not great, and we want to ship great, so let's not do that. So, like I was saying, make it hard for decision makers to bless, mediocrity. Make sure that the team understands the tools. Like, now we're just going to drill it in, and people ask themselves and say, like, hey, is that a 10? Is that a 10? Is that a 10? And now, we have entry-level people who are asking each other, is that a 10? And we don't have to do it, and the quality of the game is increasing, right? And also, as a person on the team, you can often innocuously ask this sort of question in a way that doesn't really cause anybody's feeling hurt. Like, if one of the associates I actually walked up and said, hey, Tom, do you think Omen's going to be a 10? I would have said, no, I don't. And they said, well, why are we doing it? If you said, well, why are we doing it? Then I wouldn't have had a good answer, and I wouldn't have been in with them either. I would have kind of canceled the character. So, anyway, Riven is what we use to replace Omen, which, considering how quickly we did it, especially, I was really happy with it. I think she's a terrific character. The next thing we're talking about is the Grand Unveil. And the Grand Unveil is, just sort of taking a step back, I believe firmly in the idea of sort of iterative game design, which is the idea that, you put in a game, cycles you get of trying to get feedback and changing it, the higher the quality level you get, right? And so it follows that, any sort of process or personal habit that reduces the amount of iteration you're getting is going to be a threat to quality. So if your playtest environment is down all the time, that's a threat to quality. If your designer randomly fails, that's also a threat to quality. And I will explain that. So typical manifestation is, hey Bob, go design this system. And then Bob does it. And then I ask Bob, hey Bob, how's that system going? And then Bob says to me, oh, sorry boss, you know, I'm pretty busy and it's not done yet. You know, can we talk about it maybe Monday after the weekend after work? And I say, yeah, sure, that's cool. You know, then Monday comes around and I say, hey, you know, just not quite ready, maybe Tuesday. So, you know, actually the work's being done. It's not that Bob's lazy, you know, Bob's a hard worker.
Sure to think about, like,
goal is to make a really good game. The goal is not to, have, muralist stuff in the game. If you were a designer on a successful game, that's still highly relevant. So just keep that in mind. So in terms of solving this, first, I think it's important in the process to make sure that people must show deliverables and must show progress. And that's not to be a jerk, and also, used incorrectly, this can actually produce lower quality work, but just being able to see the progress happening will force people to show the first people to iterate. I also think it's important that you make sure the feedback you're getting is just pleasant, right? You don't want to look at someone's, early work and then sit there, nitpicking the 30 obviously broken details. You want to keep it strategic and keep it positive, right? That's an interesting challenge. How are you going to fix that rather than, removing the tool list, right? We run into this in design of Google Legends. There are useful things to critique, and then there's stuff that, we can get it. Let's just not talk about that. One thing we use on Google Legends is early peer review, where if we have a champion ability kit, we'll just have a bunch of the designers, not managers, just sit in a room and talk about it. And we'll get the managers will get a summary, but they get suggestions, and the suggestions are not binding. So the designer can ignore that if they want, and sometimes they do legitimately. Other times they make a bunch of changes. But the key there is that it's a valuation that doesn't actually have the value to kind of repercussion. And I think that's really helpful. And also just having a positive mistake forgiving culture helps. I've certainly been in situations where you didn't want to say something dumb in your organization because people then start judging you as being dumb rather than and I've been in other organizations where it's throwing stuff out there was fine even if you got it it's totally wrong just to get things moving. So I think game development cultures that don't judge people for the final product and not the iterative comments are your cultures. So okay, so Shaco to give you what Shaco is now, which I think is one of the you know those champions where, you know, you either love them or hate them, and there's a lot of people that really love them, but we did need to spend an extra month to get there. Another character that falls into this is the Fire Lord. So the Fire Lord's a Warcraft hero that I worked on. I was the main designer on this. And, you know, we're going to bring some abilities, and I think he's a pretty fun champion, or hero, actually, but, you know, the artists were kind of excited about a volcano, and they're like, yeah, that's actually a really good idea, a volcano, there's like, you know, fiery boulders and magma, and like, you know, ash and smoke, and, you know, fire death, and that was really good. But, you know, there's also a siege spell. Siege spells are sort of this thing you do, you know, that's not very active, it's kind of sit there and do it, and, you know, in general, we'd already agreed with World of Warcraft, or sorry, Warcraft, I feel like, siege spells aren't such a good idea. They just don't really fit the combat model. They kind of they just don't really work that well. But we put it anyway because we couldn't put a volcano. And like, you know, this wasn't the worst thing in the world, but I think the hero could have been a lot cooler if we, you know, had done something that didn't really matter. It just felt superfluous noise. So to prevent this sort of thing, I think one thing is to make sure that you have peer review of some of these ideas by non-interested parties. Many people that, you know, weren't at lunch getting excited about it. Think structuring process to identify cost is important. So, you know, with sharks, will they agree to be set down with the producer before it goes anywhere? It's like, oh, wow, well, we need, you know, 4 months of engineering to get water and 12 months of, you know, art resources to put water in, and now this isn't looking so good. And if you do that early, you're pretty much investment. So, I think that's really the best way to stop this particular issue. Obviously, you can be cognizant of the intuitive planner. So, let's move on to the monkey thing. And, you know, we try to get champion ideas from all over the world. And monkey king actually is one of the most successful characters we've done. He just really broadly appealing, despite being, you know, Chinese in origin. Or Asian to this person. But basically, you know, we were preparing a Monkey King for launch in China. And to be a launch champion means it a little bit different. So, you know, Monkey King wanted to make him a globally killing champion, even though he had a local origin, right? And we wanted to make a character that was still true to the local legend, right? Like, he could, you know, he could be like some evil dude, right? And like, you know, he could, you know, he needed to like have a clone power probably, and certainly kind of martial arts team, right? He needed to have a staff. Like, there's some pieces there that you kind of expect if you say this is Monkey King, right? And of course, you know, Virginia is a launch character, which means that, you know, we want him to be a champion that you can have a reasonably good first game experience with. With all of our champions in League of Legends, we have a goal of having a high skill cap, but that doesn't necessarily have anything to do with the skill floor, right? Skill floor basically is like, you know, if you really aren't very good with the champion, how badly does it go, right? And and we want to say that it was too low the skill floor was the high skill cap. So yeah, and we almost go with three. So here comes a spectrum of complexity. Like, on the one hand, you have a Zen who's super technical character that really is only played well by expert players. And we actually made it for the veteran community. It is something that the veteran community asked for in the game. Maybe guys like Darren who, you know, have a very time. Like AI techniques and like
various mechanical fixes, and you know, no matter what we did, we just struggled to make it something that's comprehensible to most players. Like, even the pros in the office like just struggled to make it work. We're like, wow, this probably isn't going to be suitable for a lot of champions. And you guys would be happy to know, like, we actually have another champion in development that probably will use a mechanic like this, and I think it will work, but we also spent like another 4 months on it to try to figure it out. So the mechanic's not dead, it's just, you know, we couldn't find a way to make it work this year. So, you know, we're like, wow, we're about to ship a character that's incomprehensible to anybody who's played less than 10 games with it. Let's modify that. And I'm really happy with what we came up with. You know, which is something that I think actually has a prehensible cap as well, so we can do the monkey king, but it's still highly accessible. So, but you know, this happens a lot to us, and I think it's important that designers ask, like, you know, okay, well, we have some goals. Is what we did actually satisfying those goals, or is it not? So, you know, I think one of the things that happens that causes this also is that, you know, humans get in a situation where they think they've resolved one goal and they move on to the next goal, and then what they do in the second goal doesn't, you know, breaks the first one, or they underestimate these kind of secondary impacts of decisions they make to satisfy one goal. So fixing this, obviously, the first step is making sure that whoever is designing this understands the core goals really well. The next is to make sure we're checking, you know, work against goals, either by asking or if you're the designer, just providing them and doing it as part of a process. And of course, you know, the more people understand this kind of thing can happen, then the less it happens. So another class of problem I think happens is creative fatigue. And this is, so when the Winter Olympics were going on, I think in 2010, in the spring, or winter, I guess it was. Yeah, this guy is going to serve a couple years in a more prison problem. Basically, we try to make these custom country skins, and we asked around, like, you know, there are some, like, hey, let's have a brainstorming session to come up with, like, 10 country skins, and we need them by tomorrow, and then we'll outsource them. And so we did this, and we got this back. And, you know, it didn't work well. So kind of decompose this, right? You know, we need a lot of creative effort. So we need a lot of ideas. Let's have a 5-hour meeting, guys. Like, you know, great idea. Okay. But, you know, what your psychology professor would have told you is that attention and creativity plummet after an hour, and they actually start falling even after 15 minutes. So long meetings are really bad for creativity. They're bad for a lot of reasons, but they're bad for creativity. I actually tell my team, like, never, ever, ever schedule a meeting over an hour, unless it's a dinner meeting, then take a break in the middle of 2 hours. And, of course, you know, when you do these long meetings, you get some really substandard stuff. So, you know, I was, on World of Warcraft, the original World of Warcraft, I did a lot of outdoor monster designs with a small group. And the way this would work is we'd get, you know, these lists of, you know, like, oh, here's Tanner's Desert, and, you know, here's 30 creatures with names, and why don't you guys figure out what abilities are on? We've spent maybe, like, 2 minutes per monster coming up with the abilities. Like, oh, you know, it's a dark dwarven stunner. I guess he stuns, you know? So my final contribution was the Sparkle Shoal War. Like, oh, maybe, like, tunnels and stuff. Not just a ninja troll, but an aggressive ninja troll. So they're like walking around like, oh, it's a little workout, I'm having fun, I'm outside in Thousand Needles, and oh my god, there's 3 giant turtles chasing me. So I remember one time I came to work, you know, I had my Starbucks, and you know, I had my chocolate croissant or whatever it was, you know. And my boss, the vice president of games, I called his office, and he goes, Tom, a ninja turtle? Really? Yeah. Oh, and of course, to my former colleagues at Blizzard, now that I do not work for you guys, you do much better about this. So, all right, so there's actually another way you can create a theme, which is when you accept too many constraints. So like, you know, can't be blue, has to be human, can't be like this other thing, you know. And eventually, you don't move over, you just get bad and full. So what you have to ask for this is, you know, are the constraints mandatory? How many of those requirements are requirements, and how many of them are preferences? And or maybe some of the requirements you can actually, are not really the requirements you're talking about, but are actually like simplifications of the actual goal. So as an example, mainland China, has a regulation that you can't have exposed human bones, and you can't have exposed rotting human flesh, right? And you know, it's a very strict rule for all use in DRC. And the Korean team at Riot, you know, heard about this, but the way they heard it was, oh, you can't have undead, which is not actually what the rule is, right? So for about 6 months, we were not designing the undead champions on the thought that, you know, a third or a quarter of players just wouldn't be able to play them. And then at some point, someone asked, well, that seems pretty ridiculous because, like, really? That's a big consequence for us. And we looked at it and we're like, no, we just can't have exposed bone or rotting flesh. Like, oh, that's fine. We can totally make cool undead that don't have exposed bone or rotting flesh. Because, like, there's a lot of other human rays, you can vampires, and there's a lot of other things you can do. Happened with Poppy as well. So Poppy, we were really stuck on what else fit together. Poppy's like this little kind of small, fierce armor champion of League of Legends. And here's League of Legends that have, you know, four different abilities. And we gave her three. And they're really good. We're like, what's the fourth? And we spent all this time trying to figure it out, but we couldn't. We eventually went to the diplomatic meeting, which is problematic. I'm not even going to describe it because it's frankly incomprehensible to me as well. And and we're going to do a remake of Poppy to kind of address this issue. But what we should have done is if we had tossed one of the basic abilities, which together will form a complete kit, we would have had room to then make a good ultimate, maybe a good additional ability. So again, just refresh, positive view, creative view are long meetings and committing to each things. So fixing is obviously peer review will filter bad ideas to some extent. I also have time to boxing to fix problems. Even if it's like, we're going to spend 30 minutes on this, then we're going to revisit it 2 hours from now. Like, that's much better than we're going to have a meeting. I also think that rotating people involved is important. So, you know, you want consistency in creative decision-making. So it's not that you want to make one guy make the creative decision today and a different guy tomorrow. But you do want different inputs into the process. So you don't, like, you know, right, like, we don't want to say, like, who are the five most creative people, and we'll put them in a room and we'll come up with all the ideas. That's really bad. However, you know, what you might say is, like, well, these three people are really creative, so we'll work on this, and we'll rotate in additional people and inspiration to keep things fresh. Because even adding one person or removing a person changes the chemistry, you're going to get different ideas. And obviously, you should challenge constraints. And another thing you can use is many smaller groups will give you better output than one large group in general. There are some exceptions to this, but I generally find this to be true. We're as small as 3 to 5 people. So, last kind of thing, you know, that you're sticking with me is the designing for yourself problem. And this, you know, I think you guys all understand what this is. But basically, as a designer, you love designing, you know, do sometimes things you do complex stuff or obscure stuff that only understood by you or mostly understand by you. And you know, you do it and it does really help your game. And you know, less people get less mileage out of your mind. In the really bad cases, this can be completely crippling. We see games where major decisions are made on this basis, but usually we're manifesting games. You see a lot of tactical stuff where it's like this little Easter egg or this little extra thing is just wasted effort. So I actually did this in the Legends. So if you've ever seen a ninja movie, you know that the more ninjas are on the screen, the less powerful they are. So one ninja has this occasion in Ninja Assassin, which by the way is a really fine art in my opinion. But let's see a little go around and just track everything, right? But if there's, you know, like 15 ninjas, like even Tom Cruise defeated 15 ninjas, right? Like, the more ninjas, the less powerful. So I put this in League of Legends.
unfortunately, there was a bug, and instead of reducing hit points, it reduced damage. We then had a hotfix. So the cost of my attempt to humor through it was about 100 developer hours and 7 people being pre-PO'd. So, I still get 20, but, all right. So yeah, designers like to design what you like, and it's easy to be excited about stuff you like. And then the solutions are peer review, and of course, requiring for large initiatives that they sort of pass the normal tests that you need to pass, which are cost analysis, other people think it's a good idea too, et cetera. So this is and of course, seriously, so everyone in the audience, just ask yourself which of these decision traps you personally think you want. It will probably not be all of them, hopefully, but it will be some of them, and you should understand what you personally tend to do, and thinking about acknowledging you have this issue will help you avoid doing it. For junior designers, which I guess describes the room in general, as you're starting your career, try to get a design mentor, and it's really better if that's not your boss. It's better if someone in your company so you're not breaching confidentiality to talk to them, but I found that, my first boss in game design at Blizzard really wanted to help and really takes a lot of pride in mentorship, but there's kind of this conflicting of incentive, right? It's like, on the one hand, if I went to my boss, I'm like, hey, how about this crazy idea? If I do that too much, he might just think I kind of am not good at design, because I keep proposing ideas that aren't good. Getting someone who's not evaluating the quality of your ideas might be better, and I did this at Blizzard by developing a relationship with some mid-level and senior guys who I was kind of friends with. I'd go to lunch with them, bounce ideas and so forth, a more casual atmosphere, and I learned a lot that way. And in terms of managers, or even if you're the lead designer of your project, I think it's important to think back upon stuff you've done recently that didn't go so well, and ask yourself, did I not have the right resources, or was it bad project management, or did I have the wrong people, or was it that I just kind of fell into this sort of problem? So I really encourage you guys to do that. And thank you very much.